In the late 1950s to early 60s in Britain, Harold Macmillan's government was there. Their slogan was, "You've never had it so good." We had missed out on that. It took a few more years for it to come, but La Masse at that stage, gravelly-voiced, hard-talking Dubliner, good common sense, says, "Our people are entitled to affluence as much as anybody else," and it began to happen. And the showbands would have been part of the freedom that money gives you.
People had more money for entertainment in the 60s, and I remember, I think it was 1966, where Time magazine did a whole thing on the economy in Ireland, and entertainment was a big part of it. They had Sean Lamass on the cover, and they covered us, a big picture in them inside at the Crystal Ballroom, the queues, and inside the people out enjoying themselves, a product of a thriving economy. And it certainly was.
I think people were looking for a change, and the change of life, the change of more freedom, more money, and they wanted to change, and the Clippers came along, and they contributed to that change, not only in the fact that we followed bands rather than we went to ballrooms, but the bands give us something different, and Clippers did that, you know, something different, and they did the show.
I was still going to school when I heard the Clipper Cards playing Waterford and in Tramore, and we figured that the name for them was a show band, and that's what we eventually called ourselves, the Royal Show Band, because, you know, they did comedy. They did the stars of the moment, as we were to do later. And the whole idea of the time was to put on a show on stage, to attract people into the ballrooms more than the dancing as such.
We imitated different people, you know, film stars. We imitated, say, like Humphrey Bogart or any big star that was out at the time. There were Frank Sinatra, Crosby, anything that was going at the time, trumpet players. We featured them in the show and imitated people. And it became known then as the showpiece, the band with the show sort of thing, you know. That's how the word show band came about.
The Royal Show Band came from Waterford. The Clipper Carletons were from Strabane. And really from 1957, say, with the Clippers, through to about 1959, the Royal Show Band, until the others started joining in at 61 and 2, that was it.
Probably one of the biggest industries in the country. I mean, there was supposedly something like 600 bands at one stage.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a black beat, you can't lose it.
There were so many you couldn't keep track of them. It was just totally impossible to keep. There was more show bands. Ireland's only a small island. We went to England, Scotland, you'd play in a small town. There wouldn't even be a musician. You go to any small village in Ireland, whether it's in Donegal, Kerry, Cork, anywhere, you'll go to a small village, not only have you a group, you'd have five or six groups in the one place. You could have a show band. There were show bands everywhere in Ireland, everywhere.
It's gotta be rock and roll music if you wanna dance and play.
There was hunters and hunters of them. It was very healthy, the music business there in the 60s and all, and there were so many show bands, as you say, and there were so many ballrooms all over the country, like. For the size of Ireland, you know, and they all. There was only maybe a handful of like the top show bands. You know what I mean?
There were a lot of bands appeared as if by magic, like, you know, with various names. Names of which have escaped me, although some of them might still be around making the odd record. You know, But they were only in it for the money, I think, anyway, you know, because they wouldn't have been in the top flight of musicians.
There was the Premier Division, and the Premier Division, the popularity of that supported the First Division, and right on down. But it was a big industry dominated by a few very big bands.
It got to the stage where it became so popular that any guys, and it was always guys with only one or two exceptions that I can think of, any guys that were able to play at all were on stage or had the slightest interest in music, the slightest interest. They'd be on the stage playing in a band, you know.
It's a little old lady from Pasadena. Super Star Car. Everybody knows that there's nobody Nina. Little old lady from Pasadena. She drives so hard. She's a terror of Colorado Boulevard. It's a little old lady from Pasadena. Go, Nina.
The traveling, it was pretty sore on you because you were working against the grain. You were in bed when you should have been up, and you were up when you should have been in bed. I always compared musicians to vampires. They're running around all night, and the next thing, they have to be back in the coffin before the sun rises, like they're like vampires.
Your whole cycle was changed around. You were sleeping when everyone else was awake. You know what I mean? And then you were traveling and the whole lot. So it took your whole body an awful long time to adjust.
And we were lumbered by the fact that we lived in Cork. You couldn't go much souther than that. And if your gig was in Belfast on a Tuesday night, you left Cork at 10 o'clock in the morning Tuesday to get to the gig.
The roads weren't as good as they are nowadays. Like, people complain about the roads, but when we were travelling at that time, the wagons weren't as fast, I suppose. You had all the equipment and all the guys in the wagon. Now, this led to a lot of friction as well.
But that's the way it was. The fights were good, though, because all of a sudden, the journey would be over. It'd be boring if nothing was happening, you know. But it was awful. We did about 2,000 miles a week.
We played in Limerick one night in the Stella Ballroom in Limerick, and there wasn't one of the eight speaking to any other member. And it was the rarest night because you didn't know who to ask, what are we playing next. And if you asked that fella, he wasn't speaking to you, and he wasn't speaking to him. And I don't know how we got the night. And after the gig was over, the Stella Ballroom, the people came up and said, I never heard you better.
The bands that wouldn't have the big crowds wrote nasty things on walls, like, who was here last night, who's the best sax player in the world and all that. And they used to leave messages for us. And one in particular was written, I think, in Waterford, in the Olympia, and it said, fame and fortune has not changed the Dixies. They're still bastards.
At the time, there were an awful lot of bands on the road now, which aren't there anymore. Like, you don't have the same sort of rapport with groups anymore or that sort of thing, because there aren't that many travelling. But in those days, you had a lot of bands travelling the country. I mean, there was about 600 bands.
Ah, of course, you'd meet all the bands on the road, and all right, you know, a bit of crack and stopping out there. There used to be an awful lot of carry-on them days, like, I mean, throwing eggs at each other, you know what I mean? Like, vans passing each other on the road.
So you were bound to meet them in different filling stations, at different garages, at different cafes, different places around the country where everybody used to congregate every now and again, and you'd always meet at least two to three bands on any given night out.
You would go to your way to be stay in the same hotel, you know, say, where do the bands stay? There were hotels where we stayed, and you could meet other bands. Now, most of the Dublin bands went home. You know what I mean? Because it, no matter where they went in Ireland, it still wasn't an awful journey. They stayed over sometimes. But we had hotels that we singled out to stay in, where we would eventually be barred from.
I held her hand. So hard to understand.
Nights I played, not me, most of us, we'd have our nice blue suits and we'd be staying over with the pajamas that'd be under the suits until about 11 o'clock, then we'd take them off. That's how cold it was, because they wouldn't really heat the ballrooms. Why heat them? It's going to be too hot later on, so you'd freeze for the first thing, you know. And as I say, if you're supposed to be a sex symbol with a blue nose, it doesn't work.
Picture it yourself in your mind. You come into the entrance. Normally you would have the ladies' cloakroom and the gents' cloakroom and maybe the pay box. Went up the floor, the big square floor, nothing else, just seats, a couple of seats at the seat side of it. And then the bandstand and the wee room at the side for the band to change.
You walked in and there was the white, you know, the whitey stuff from the, coming up from the concrete floors. There was nothing put down on them. The concrete walls, not plastered, and then a plain just bulb hanging down. No shade, no nothing. And there wasn't even a mirror.
I remember distinctly seeing a sign up once, proposed site for new mirror. It never appeared.
I used to do the Jolson's thing, put all the black up, makeup and all. And I had it wash that off with a bottle of lemonade. There wasn't any water to be got.
You know, it'd be so cold in the place, and one of those big industrial space heaters, and it looks like a jet engine, you know, blowing whatever bit of heat it could. Many's the shirt I burned a hole in trying to warm it up. You know, you'd go away for a few minutes, and you come back and you'd find this big brown hole in the middle of your shirt. You know. If you were lucky, it was the back. You'd still have to wear it, you know.
It was a bit skimped, I felt. It was like, get in, get the money, get in for the kill, because it's not going to last.
I mean, no toilet facilities, no food to be had. I mean, a band would arrive at a ballroom in a rural area in those times, maybe after travelling 150, 200 miles, and they wouldn't even get a cup of tea.
I remember we were playing one night in a ballroom, and it was in an upstairs place. And I remember sitting drumming, and two people just disappeared. The floor gave way.
They were dreadful, like, but when you had 2,200 people in them at 10 bobbies, it didn't look bad at all, to tell you the truth. You know, really too glad to see this number coming off the walls, you know. It was heat that did that, you know. Sweat.
Was everything, on and off stage, and that's the way we were groomed. And a funny thing, it sticks with you. You mightn't think it to look at me if you saw me walking down the street today, but you're always on stage in show business. Even when we had a night off, people will recognize you.
They saw these bright blue suits, and it lit up the stage and focused attention on the band, and that's what we were aiming to do.
And then the bands that come on, they may have been good bands and all that there, but maybe just the white shirt and the black trousers, like they wouldn't have had the same impact. I seen us getting the applause in Cork, just walking on with the new suits and all the stuff like that there before we played a note.
He went for the blue jacket and the white trousers with the stripe down the side, the white shoes they had and the cap, and It was just gorgeous, you know what I mean? And I mean, immediately they stood out from all the fellas, I mean, in the ballroom, and the girls thought they were gorgeous, you know what I mean?
There was image to be thought about as well, you know? I mean, it's all very well, but if you had your punters coming to see you in the local chipper, like, it's not good, you know? The trick is to arrive in, as I say, a red Italian sports car and waft into the place, you know? Or be wafted in even better, you know. Then it was good then, because there'd be a big queue of people outside the hall, and the band would appear, you know. And it had to be something special, like, you know. How could you charge them the money if you weren't special?
It was a total cash economy at that time. Like, the ballrooms were, they you paid cash into the ballroom. The band was paid cash that night. All the boys were divvied up in cash, or the most of them were paid in cash that night. It was a hip-pocket economy, you know, and a lot of people had a lot of folding money to spend, and they were great spenders. There is no question about that. They were some of the most foolhardy, extravagant people I have ever met who really spent money on old nonsense.
I remember even 1957 getting £5 for a Sunday night, whereas I'd work a whole week in the paper mills for £4.
And the money that was made, and the money that was spent, we didn't keep much of it. If I converted it, that year, working it out, that's the 60-40, it's almost 70-30, it was like 120,000 converted to now is $2 million in 1 year.
Either you go in the transit van and sit in misery and eat hamburgers, like, or you spend enough to keep yourself reasonably sane, like.
Money didn't mean anything much to me them days, you know what I mean? Whatever few bob I got, I drank it. Like many other few fellas in this business, in the show been saying, you know.
Now, the majority of the bands, I would say 9 out of 10 bands went down, they were half shot before they even got near the stage. And to the extent that this is the truth, and some of the bands will tell you this, if it was a 7-piece band, say, or an 8-piece band, they used to send 2 or 3 out, drums and somebody on the keyboard or somebody on the sax just to play a couple of numbers, and the rest of the boys were still gargling. And then when they finished a couple of numbers, they come back and they started to gargle all the way through it, with the result coming near the end of the dance, they're all pie-eyed.
But for some strange reason, they were still able to do their job. You know, they could go on and perform even though they were drunk.
At the break, fellas would be really, you'd be after, you would have done a couple of hours, maybe 2.5 hours, and you knew you had another couple of hours to go. So guys would have a couple of drinks, a little drop of whiskey or some sort of an injection, you know what I mean? And in most of the bands, I would say, and which led to a lot of grief later on for a lot of guys.
I would never encourage anybody to smoke or to drink, because it's a drug, and once you get hooked, it's very difficult to get off. Show business is the same. It is a drug. Everybody loves to get up and sing a song at a party on a stage and have a bit of laugh and all. But then you have the ones who are successful over the years, Joe Dowell and myself, you know, like from those years, who have lasted till now. But all the ones then who tried it, got the drug, and are singing in Mickey Mouse pubs, Mickey Mouse money, Mickey Mouse dressing rooms, they can't get off it.
In some of the top show bands, like, you know, Dickie Rock and Joe Dolan and Butch Moore, were all tremendous singers and were able to produce a variety of songs as good, if not better, than some of the originals.
Because we used to get together, do the steps, number one, we'd do the rhythm section, which I'd play rhythm guitar and all that, and the ones I wasn't singing, we'd get each beat down, and whoever was singing it, we'd get the phrasing down, not just the words. Anyone could do that. A lot of the show bands did do that. But we did everything. We did the phrasing to the last nuance. And sometimes some of these great singers you thought had a hit record, Jesus, it wasn't that good. We changed it, naturally, it came out better.
We were kind of bringing the foreign, or the American, the big American stars, and even the big English stars, into the Irish ballrooms for them. And I think that was a lot of the success, of course it was. You know, there was originality lacking, but I mean, there was certainly, the performance wasn't lacking.
You had Brendan Boyer, who did an Elvis routine, which was quite astonishing to see a big lump of a fella from Waterford, who was never, shall we say, the most delicate person in the world. He was quite an awkward fella, really. And, you know, it was always America that he didn't fall. I often thought the way he used to go dancing across the stage at the time. And people, it wasn't that he did it well, I suppose, like a dog walking on its hind legs. It's that he could do it at all.
Oh, you teddy bear.
Showbands could absorb anything. You know, you whistle it and they'll play it. Should, if there was, some of them at least, if there was a Beethoven symphony made number one by Freak, they would have a stab at it.
When we were copying the records, even the solos that were playing, the sax solos and all, the sax player was copying his solo, or the trumpet in the band. I was copying exactly what was on the trumpet.
Being a songwriter, I think you would have suffered had you been in a band. There might have been some bands, maybe like the Freshmen or something like that, that might have been open to new material. But you see, they were, the likes of them got the stamp. They sang all the Beach Boys stuff. That's what the punters went to hear.
We did one original album. In fact, we did two albums in which they were good few original. We used to incorporate them into the program, I think, but nobody ever noticed any difference that I noticed. You know,
I used to have terrible arguments because I wanted to do these songs and like they probably weren't suited and all that there. Like at the time the soul music came on and all that there, I wanted to do all that kind of like American soul music, and I mean, it wouldn't entertain it. Like.
And there was Rob Strong singing his heart out, like, and John Trotter, they were, that was the time all that Blood, Sweat and Tears thing was in it, and they were good at it, you know, they were good. And they may as well. It was a waste, complete waste of time, you know. The people still wanted to hear the Clancy Brothers or something, you know, what they'd be shouting up. You'd be getting requests, you know. Fine girl you are.
Kiss me quick while we still have this feeling.
Suddenly the Irish public were hearing the bands that they were dancing to on the radio and on television. It was a whole unique experience. So really, the 45 record that you made was a promotional disc as such. And if you were lucky, it was a hit. And if it was a hit, of course, it didn't mean a lot of copies in Ireland. The Hooker Book was an exception. I think a number one hit like Kiss Me Quick was like 20,000 records.
Kiss me quick, I just can't stand this waiting. Cause your lips are lips I long to know.
If your records were being played, it kept you in the public eye, and if you were in the charts, then you had bigger crowds at the bar. That's the only way you made money on it, by the way. Bigger crowds will come into the ballrooms.
If you were going to Galway and your record had been played a few times on Larry Gogan or Val Joyce or something like that, during the week there was a build-up, and you'd associate, oh, the Dixies are coming, did you hear their new record? And that was it, very important.
It wasn't important at all. It became... The Royal had a hit in England with something, and I think the Mighty Evans had a couple of ghost hits in England, and then, but it didn't matter. It would have been nice. The idea wasn't it was really only to have it played in the radio. As I say, records then were simply used as promotional material. So we got wide to it at the last, through the good of us. I think it was the great brain of Oliver Barry came up with it. Why not just make them hits in everybody's mind?
But showband records might have a sort of cruel fascination for people who like high camp and high kitsch, but I don't think many of them, their I can't think of any classics that were there.
A lot of the records didn't sell all that well, I think, and there used to be funny rumours around, too, at one stage that some of these bands bought their own records to hype them into the charts. And there was a certain amount of truth in that, I think.
In the beginning, I remember Fallen Star, that was my first record. We went to number one. We must have only bought about... I remember going, nay. And I got my mother and me sister to go in, pack it. There's £2, go in and buy two records. You know, I mean, it was done on that scale in the beginning. The boys got a few pound. That's all we bought. It was dribbly, dribbly. But afterwards, you'd be going... I think, I don't know whether there was something done or not, but records were, there was loads of boxes of records hanging around. But I suppose it was to give it a boost.
If you had sold 1 million records on the first day, you still might not have been on the charts if you didn't watch what you were doing. You know, it was as simple as that.
Of course. I mean, that practice, I'm sure, I'm not sure if it happens now all over the world, but it did in a big way. You knew the shops that would give returns to the charts, so you went and you sort of helped them a little bit. You told people where to go and buy them.
But the bigger bands, certainly, like Brendan Boyer, the Royal Showband, did sell records in huge quantity. The Dixies would have sold records in large quantity. And somebody like Joe Dolan, of course, I mean, was the first, really, I think, to have hit records internationally. He established the name of the Irish show bands on an international scene with hits in Britain and indeed elsewhere in South Africa, we were told at the time.
I was never totally interested in sort of furthering the cause of anything abroad or sort of enhancing the Irish show business thing overseas or anything like that. I was thinking of what we could do, what I could do for me. So genuinely, that's the way I was thinking. If I said anything else, it's a lie, but it's you know, I like to think that I did it for me.
You have taught me, and I'm different now. Take me and break me and close all your windows and doors. Shut me off, make me an island, I'm yours.
We kept Ireland going at the same time. Now, we were big in Ireland, like really big. After Make Me an Island came out, now the whole thing blossomed up into the sky. So while we were doing things, like we'd fly out to France and we'd record a show at 4 o'clock and we'd fly back and we'd go on in the Iron, let's say. Or we'd go to Germany and we'd fly back and go to Kilchimock. Or we'd go to... Holland, anywhere, Belgium, anywhere. And we were doing that all the time. I used to do that about 3 times a fortnight. You'd fly out and come back and still do the gig here. You always kept the home market going, just in case the ass fell out of the other one.
But we didn't concentrate in getting out to the world because of the fact that it was so great in Ireland. The money was so great. Why leave it? It was, as I say, like the song... Those were the days, my friend. We thought they'd never end, and they did. But we didn't think they would.
See, one of the prices we paid, I paid and the Miami paid, I suppose particularly myself as the front man and the performer, is that we were comfortable at home. We were economically successful at home. So it's like the guy, any guy or girl who hasn't got a job maybe here or not doing great or... paying so much tax that can't make a living, they have to emigrate. We were doing well, as I say, we were economically viable, so we didn't have to go away. And in a way, that probably held me back on making it internationally.
Viva Las Vegas, turning day into nighttime, night into daytime, if you see it once, you'll never be the same again. I'm gonna keep on the run.
I remember being in Las Vegas at the time, and people, show bands, would have been seen like something you'd analyze the word show and band. And there'd be these bands that would stand up in Las Vegas who were musically astonishingly good. And when you spoke to promoters and musicians in Las Vegas, they would expect really slick jazz guys. And these Irish bands would come in who musically certainly would not have been as proficient, as inventive, or as, you know, you wouldn't have had the virtuosity in the playing, but they had, they more than, you know, they blew the American bands away just with enthusiasm and with warmth.
The success of the Royal Showband in Las Vegas was a band from Ireland doing their Irish material, but also doing the American material. The combined effort of both, I think one without the other wouldn't have worked.
I know other Irish bands went over and auditioned and didn't get it because they were playing, you know, American-style songs and whatever, when the real thing was only next door, do you know what I mean? If you went over and sang, took off Elvis, and Elvis was only in the pub next door or the club next door, you're wasting your time. They wanted Irish, humorous, and that's what we did.
There's a boy, a little boy, shooting arrows in the blue, and he's aiming them at someone, but the question is at who? Is it me, or is it you? It's hard to tell until you're hit, but you'll know it.
Our act was, of course, if you're ever coming to the parlour, Danny Boy, Little Green Apples. But we used to do a tap dance routine, we used to do a bagpipe routine, we had three sets of bagpipes that come out and play in kilts. So we became then recognized as, I don't know if we got an award for it, as being the most on Vegas act in Vegas.
We brought the four Hucklebuck girls and had them Irish dancing as well as hucklebucking, and the whole thing turned into a review scene, and we became Ireland's Royal Showband at the Stardust Hotel, and we started doing that for 6 months a year. And as it turned out, that proved to be a tremendous move, because it limited, we only had to play once or twice in each venue in Ireland, and we were here for 6 months as well.
It meant that there was an appetite for them when they came back, because they had missed them for the 6 months.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is with pleasure that I'm able to present to you this evening from Waterford the famous Royal Showband.
In my opinion, the Royal Showband did serious damage to the business in the late 60s, well, the mid 60s rather, because they were so popular at that time that they decided, why should we be appearing for 5 hours on stage or performing for 5 hours on stage when we would possibly do a better show for 2 hours and get the same money? And therefore, they created, at that time, the advent of the relief band. And that did serious damage to the business.
You were playing from a 9 to 2 dance, and you went, no matter if you were the Royal and if you were, and you went at 9 o'clock. Like, things were changing, and you had the young people going to the bars in that town, in the town, and they were staying there till 11 o'clock. So you were on stage for 2 hours without anybody being in the hall.
And when rock and roll came into the bars, which it did in Dublin first, it really took a big slice out of the action. But relief bands could be a little bit of blame, but I don't think a lot.
You're doing so good, all of a sudden you could afford a relief band. You know, it'd be great to have a nice easy meal instead of rushing up with a sandwich. Let's have a nice easy meal and get ready, right, you know, and take our time instead of rushing into the toilet and changing your clothes and all that. It was the easy way out. It was.
We could do a dynamite show for 2 hours, but ask you to play for 5 hours, you were nagging, you know. And there was a dreadful period. Jerry Anderson used to call it from 9 to eternity. It used to be the hours of dancing, you know. And by the time the people came into the hall at 11 o'clock, you had a blue shadow from where you should have been shaving again, you know, you'd be standing there. It used to be wild, and it was cold, and it was miserable, and there was no excitement at all. And by the time it came to do your show, you were so pissed off in there, the thing, you didn't want to bother, you know.
I don't think that it was the fact that the relief band, what I think was the downfall of a lot of the bands. I mean, the Royal and the Captain and all these, other bands had a great show on stage. And a lot of the other new bands that were coming up didn't put that kind of show on stage for the punter. And that's what I think happened. That show went out of Showband.
And we were sitting on our laurels a little bit. Tom Dunphy wanted to branch out, and I know he did. I was offered a phenomenal amount of money to go with the Tribune, which was at that time Noel Pearson, Mike Quinn, Dan McGrattan, and a former band on a weekly, and they offered me this phenomenal sum of money to do it, and I considered doing it, and I gave them a tentative yes. And in the meantime, the guys, some of the guys, the Royal, kind of rallied around among themselves and said, listen, we mustn't let Brendan go because, I mean, we made a counteroffer. So the boys came back and made me a counteroffer of a double share in the band from 1970 on. It probably was the end of the Royal, the fact that we were all on an equal share was, I think, one of the big things of the Royal Showband, and maybe that was just the beginning of the end.
When the word came that the Royal Showband were splitting and the Big Eight was being formed, and I was asked, would I go as band leader and pick the band and go to Las Vegas and all that? It was an easy decision to make at the time.
And it wasn't until we came along with the Big Eight. And it was the Big Eight put show back into showband, with so much talent and so much show on stage, that the crowds came back again. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la.
I mean, we were at the top of the heap because we had 7 months of the year in Las Vegas, and we only came back and did the cream of the gigs around here for the winter, really, and then we got sort of Christmas at home, and we were straight back out the 1st of January to Las Vegas. So, I mean, as showband jobs go, I probably got the pick of the bunch at the time.
We were still playing popular music, a lot of standards, and we're still doing a bit of comedy, you know, and Paddy Cole would feature instrumentally. We would do anything and everything. It was just a whole... We could do anything from Sinatra to Presley to country to trad jazz to... It was just a whole complete shebang of everything.
The shows just keep going. You know, they just follow through one after the other. And we worked back-to-back with a superb review called A Bare Touch of Vegas. 10 topless, stunningly beautiful topless women and one Polynesian guy who did the most amazing show. We followed them directly around. I mean, when I came out first, I thought it was lunacy. They were going out to the strains of Genesis, you know, going around one side, and we were coming around with, if you're Irish, come into the pan. Oh, my God, this is so embarrassing. But it turns out, actually, that there were more, the crowds were only pouring in for our show, you know. No account of her taste.
But we were doing the same show, three times a night, six nights a week, and that's what used to really get to me, there was no change of music, and you became sort of mechanically playing. And when we used to rehearse for coming back home to rehearse a different program, you found that it was getting harder to rehearse all the time because you were so used to just doing the same thing. And then we'd come back home to Ireland and spend a few months for the summer here, which was also the ideal situation because we'd been rested for 6-7 months. We came home, band was huge in Ireland as well. So we thought we had everything really great. We were going to Ballybunion and we were ready to go on stage, and I got a message, but there was a phone call from me in the manager's office. I went up, the manager of the ballroom just said to me, Paddy, after getting a phone call to tell you dreadful news, Tom Dunphy's just been killed on the way to a gig to Donegal.
I think the whole world of the showband world that I've just ground to a standstill, and I will never forget his funeral. I mean, of its day, it would have been on a par with like a Princess Diana in Ireland. I mean, there were just thousands of people lined the streets, and I think we all felt a terrible sense of reckoning.
To me personally, he was just a tragic loss. I had a lot of problems afterwards with alcoholism and a lot of things, but that was the easy way out. But it's hard to measure. I really can't measure Tom's loss because there was so much personal loss.
That was an awful tragedy at that time because Tom Dunphy and the Miami tragedy all happened around about the same time. And I was in the Tara Club, had done a gig there, and Frank McLoone, Collie Lynch and myself sat on a little bit late, and I came out and I got the paper at the corner. And the guy that sold me the paper said, well, how are you, Paddy? There's been an accident at the border or something, that somebody told me, and I think there's a band involved. I said, God, you're joking. So I went home to the house. I was living in Dublin at the time, and I went home to the house and phoned the press, I think it was. No, it was the Independent. And Tony Wilson, who was an English guy who was a reporter, who did a showbiz page here, answered the phone. And this was 5 o'clock in the morning or 6 o'clock in the morning. So I said, uh-oh, there must be something serious. And I said, Tony, I heard a rumour. And he said, yeah, it's the Miami. And I said, a crash. And he said, no, there's been a shooting. And I believe some of them are dead.
We were stopped one night by a bogus military checkpoint. The UVF, there's a loyalist paramilitary organisation. And while pretending to check our credentials at the side of the road, they proceeded to put a bomb into the back of the van, and we would have said, they would have said, thanks very much, off you go, lads, great, and going through maybe Dundalk or Newry, it would have gone off, and nobody would have known about the checkpoint, and people would have said, well, Miami were carrying bombs or whatever, but it didn't work out like that, and for one reason or another, the bomb went off while they were talking to us, and they proceeded to shoot. Everybody had killed two of their people, so it was just one of those terrible incidents. One of the black days for the showband industry, really.
But it left a mark. Bands stopped travelling north. Somehow it was like their immunity was taken away, and, you know, everybody's a target now. It devastated the entertainment business in Northern Ireland, understandably, and it also really was a very deep wound in the psyche of the whole entertainment business, north and south. It's a terribly sad event.
In fact, quite the contrary. I think that would have been one of the exciting things to happen, and I know it sounds strange to say that, but in show business, any sort of publicity is good, so for something like that to happen would have concentrated the mind on the showband industry again, and whether it was out of sympathy or voyeurism or whatever, it became the showband industry got a bit of a boost. I mean, we, as I say, saw the big time after that. People came out to see us, and the band was quite good. We put a very good band together, but I was never confident. I'd practiced my instrument, or I'd practiced my craft all my life, and here were people coming out to see me that probably couldn't care less whether I played a B or a B flat, you know. It's as if it happened to somebody else. What happened to us, it wasn't personal, and I don't feel that that I should carry that round with me for the rest of my life. There was enough hurt and injury caused by that. I just feel happy to be here to be able to talk about it. It hasn't affected me badly, I don't think so anyway, although I suppose I'd be the last to know.
If I didn't have a dime, if I didn't take the time to play the jukebox, whoa, Saturday night would have been a sad and lonely night for me. Uh-huh. And if I didn't see you there, ruby lips and golden hair beside the jukebox, whoa, I would have lost my chance to hold you while you dance with me.
I don't think people did realize the industry that it was. And it was let die. It was let die very quietly. And the discos were coming in hotels at the time. And hoteliers suddenly saw they could pay one guy to spin a few records. And I don't mean that in a flippant sort of way, but just to play records, they were paying one guy, and they didn't have to pay a band. And the bands didn't see this coming along. Plus the fact, I think one of the major reasons was that the ballrooms weren't licensed.
Drink. Drink has a lot to answer for in this country. Drink has rung in so many changes to individuals and to society. It was when people began to demand more, they were more affluent, they had the money, and quite rightly the consumer rules. So people thought before that they would have to go and lorry drink into themselves quickly, then go to the dance and get out of it. Then people began to put proper stages into cabaret clubs. They would build big cabaret clubs. There you could go, you could have a drink. There'd be top entertainers on the stage, and there'd be a dance floor there too.
Many, many is the time that we lobbied the politicians, ministers, etc., to get drinks licenses for the ballrooms, so that we'd survive, because we saw it as a really a survival situation in those times. But, you know, the politicians didn't want to bring, I suppose, the rot of the mothers and fathers around the country on them by giving a drink license to the local ballroom.
So why should you, you know, brave your way in this very crude thing with a mineral bar, with perhaps a cup of tea if they were in the luxury end of things, and, you know, not particularly good toilet facilities or anything like that. I think just people became more sophisticated, more demanding. They wanted better things, and the dance halls had outlived their usefulness.
They did play an enormous part in the development of taking a closed Ireland to an open Ireland, to a closed Ireland, very disciplined Ireland, to an Ireland that did what they wanted to do. And that's the Ireland, it's the children of those people who've produced the confident Ireland today. But it was an essential element in the evolution of Ireland that we should have got away from the totally disciplined, do what you're told, be home, don't move, don't go, to the people who the confidence to do what they liked. And that confidence started with deciding to travel all over the country after Showbands.
When you were going out to hear somebody from England or someone like that, they're coming over to do a tour, it was all right, it was fine, you paid your money like there. But all of a sudden, when you got the Brenton Byers and the Joe Dolans and the Dickie Rocks and all the heads coming, when you got out to see me, you were kind of way proud that I know him. Like, he lives a couple of streets from me, or Big Glover lives in Glengormley, you know, I know him well and all. They were very proud of you doing something that the English people and the Scottish people and all these Americans coming on tour, that we had the local band just as good.
But one thing of the showband scene, which I'd learned, you develop your ear through listening for all the years that you've been it, and I'd learned you how to entertain people, you know, which is very important, you know. There's no use being the greatest guitar player in the world or the greatest singer, and you can't go out there and entertain. You might be talented, like, but can you entertain this crowd? So that's what the showband scene that really learned you how to go out and entertain people. So that's what it's all about at the end of the day, you know.
To be a top showband in this country was to be internationally big, because everything was coming in. Everything that came into people's heads came in from the outside. They never got to see anything international. In fact, there was no internationality when you come to think of it. Like, America was a lost cause. Europe was unheard of, you know. People hadn't even started to go there for their holidays at that stage. Like, and there were certainly no bands coming out of Europe, not then nor since, come to think of it, you know, bar an odd one from Holland, maybe. So to be in the top showbands was to be as high as you could go in entertainment.
It was essentially part of what we are. It certainly is part of what we were. And it was, you know, a sort of, you know, the part of the passage of the people. You know, it was a sort of a period we had to go through, and I think the show bands, I think the country owes them a hell of a debt, because they did make growing up in Ireland a lot of fun at that time. And as I say, the majority of people over 30 in this country today can think back very hard, because probably the notion of them could very well have come about because of the music of the show band.
Everybody, I'd like to play.